Let's go to this meeting between you and Mr. Haldeman and Mr. Dean following the March 21st meeting of Dean with the President. That's when the roof sort of started to cave in. And I'm curious to know what transpired in that meeting between the three of you after the meeting between Dean and the President, when presumably, according to Dean's testimony, substantiated by Moore and what Dean told Moore, Dean told the President everything he knew about Watergate. Then there was a meeting, as I understand it, between the three of you.
There was a meeting at 3:45 on the 21st.
Yes.
And then that meeting moved to the President's office at after about an hour. Mr. Dean did not report in my hearing what he had told the President that day.
He never mentioned anything about his meeting with the President?
No, sir. Not that I can recall at all. We were largely taken up both at that meeting and continuing in the meeting which took place in the President's office afterward with the question of how to get the story out, number one, how to get White House people to testify fully, under what circumstances, whether they should be made fully available to this committee, waiving all privilege, or whether they should be made available fully to the grand jury and not to this committee at all. Whether the attorney-client privilege still existed as to Dean, and he talked to us quite a bit about the law of attorney-client privilege, as I recall, at that occasion. And so it was that setting. Now, Mr. Dean and I got into a difference of opinion at that time about the question of immunity and how that should be handled. As I recall, right around this time, I think...
Now, what do you mean about immunity?
Well, his theory was that the President should negotiate blanket immunity for the White House staff with the Attorney General so that the entire White House staff, lock, stock, and barrel, could testify freely before the grand jury as to any and all facts and clear the air, and everybody be immune from prosecution. That just didn't make any sense to me from either a practical standpoint or a public appearance standpoint. And we got into a difference of opinion on that.
Well, now
that was again. Pardon me, sir.
Well, why did he say that?
Well, he was looking for formulae. He had come up with a concept that there ought to be some kind of a commission, an independent commission that would be set up.
But when somebody talks about immunity, obviously they're afraid of ending up in the pokey. Did he say, now we're all going to jail,
No. So
we'd better get some immunity here?
No. He said that he was concerned that people would not talk freely. Now, Mr. Dean is an immunity expert. Mr. Dean told us early in the game that he was the author of the statute, which the Congress eventually adopted, granting immunity to people in certain criminal situations so that they would testify against hires up or co-conspirators or whatnot. And so he gave us quite an accounting of the difference between use immunity and transactional immunity and the various technicalities of this. And he explained that immunity was the sort of the lubricant that was needed in this thing to get people to come forward and to fully tell their stories.
But if everybody is innocent of everything, and
well, I don't think at that
stopped with Liddy, why would people worry about immunity?
Well, I don't think at that stage that there was any necessary assumption on our part that everybody was innocent of everything. I think it was implicit in the conversation that there were liabilities. Now, we were thinking in terms of Mr. Magruder. We were thinking in terms of people at the committee, but. Mr. Dean was also implying to us that people in the White House would not come forward and testify freely without immunity. This was a line that picked up, I guess, about this time, and then was replayed over and over in his conversations with Mr. Haldeman.
Now, did he mention to you in this discussion who would need immunity in the White House?
No, he did not.
No names were mentioned at all?
No, sir. Not that I can recall.
Now, who did you think might, because you had some discussion on this?
I don't think that I thought who might at that point. Bear in mind, I had been totally out of touch with this situation for some period of time. My reaction to his proposal was to simply say to him that that was out of the question, that we simply could not expect anybody to grant immunity, either on a blanket basis or on an individual basis, to anybody in the White House. Now, I said that rather early in the conversation, and that may have inhibited any specifics that Mr. Dean otherwise might have been willing to come forward with. But
what was Mr. Haldeman's reaction?
He didn't express a reaction that I can recall to that. He was concerned, as I recall, with the general subject of executive privilege, because he'd been hearing from Mr. Mitchell strongly about executive privilege, and he conveyed to us Mr. Mitchell's strong feeling that the executive privilege position that the administration was taking was untenable.
And he didn't say anything about this conversation. He'd had this long conversation earlier in the day with the President of the United States.
No, sir. He did not.
Did you know at that time about who were... may have been knowledgeable about the break-in? Did you know at some point in time he told you that some people knew about it?
Oh, no.
But this was later.
That developed as a result of phone calls that Bob Haldeman was getting while we were in San Clemente following...
I don't want to get bogged down on
that. Yeah, I left about 5 or 6 days later to California. While we were out there, we began realizing there was a strong conflict between Dean and Mitchell on this whole question of people going to the grand jury or the committee and so on. And we couldn't get a feel of it. I didn't know what was behind it, and I began trying to find out what was behind it. And then I talked to Mr. O'Brien. And that is the first that I knew about these four meetings back in November and December and January and February where these plans were laid. Then I began inquiring through Mr. Moore and others as to what Mr. Mitchell might have testified to that was worrying him and why he didn't think Dean ought to go near the U.S. attorney or the grand jury and what his concerns were.
Is it fair to say that up to this March 21st date, you had no knowledge of what Dean's activities were in connection with Watergate? Now I'm talking about possible illegal activities, other than the comeback business and this talk you had on executive clemency. Is that a fair thing to say?
I didn't know what he had to do with the comeback business, except in the recruiting of Mr. Comeback.
Well, I'm only talking about what's transpired here in this week.
Right. I do not know about what lay behind that in terms of these meetings in Dean's office with LaRue and Comeback.
But you knew nothing about his activities other than these little bits and pieces that we've mentioned.
Well, in retrospect, I evidently knew about bits and pieces, but I never had enough to alert me to put it together.
Well, all right. Is there anything else that occurred in that 1 hour that we should know? Back to the March 21st meeting in your office, Haldeman.
You will get better information, I think, on that meeting from Mr. Haldeman, since I believe he took notes during the meeting. I did not.
What transpired in the President's office now when you moved the meeting over there?
There was virtually a replay of this difference of opinion between Dean and me on the question of immunity for the White House staff. The President was advancing a premise at that meeting. Everybody goes to the grand jury. Nobody goes to the Senate committee. And we go to the grand jury right away. And the White House staff marches down there in platoons, if necessary. And we get it all cleaned up. And if there's any problem, why, the problems are smoked out.
Was that the decision when
no,
the meeting ended?
No, I say it was advanced as a sort of a premise for argument. And Mr. Dean said, well, that's what I've been saying. We ought to do that. We ought to do it under a blanket immunity. And that way all the truth will come out. And I was saying, I just think that's wrong, number one. I don't think anybody in the White House is entitled to immunity. If they've done something wrong, then they ought to take a penalty. More than that, I think it would be just terribly misunderstood by the American people.
Now, what was Haldeman's position?
You'll find that throughout these kinds of things, Mr. Haldeman seldom, if ever, takes a an advisory position.
He listens,
he takes notes, undoubtedly gives his opinion, but he doesn't usually give it in an open meeting.
Of course, he must have realized that he was involved in some way here. I should think he'd have some opinion upon his future in a very important meeting like this.
I'm not sure that either he or I had any real appreciation at that point in time that we were, in fact, involved in this, as you put it.
Well, but we do have the evidence that he instructed Strawn to shred some papers that might have some light on this.
Senator, I must say, that story has arisen in the last 6 weeks, as far as
I know. I'm not saying you knew anything about that. I'm simply saying I'm surprised
I don't think
at
he
all.
Knew. I don't think he knew about it either. I interviewed Strawn at great length, and my notes are here. And I asked him, because I was trying to find out about Mr. Haldeman, frankly. I said, tell me everything you know about how Haldeman might be tied into this thing. And he gave me four or five instances of some contact that Mr. Haldeman might have had with the Watergate business. There was not a scintilla of a mention of shredding documents anywhere in that.
You're saying is that we may get different testimony from the next witness.
Well, And I'm saying, too, that as we sat in this March 21st meeting, I don't think Mr. Haldeman or I had any contemplation that there was going to be a suggestion of our implication.
Well, now, what did the president say to this difference of opinion between you and Dean on immunity?
He said that he would like to have us have a meeting with John Mitchell and sit down and talk with him not only about that, about the basic question of whether staff should appear here or at the grand jury or both, but also recasting the administration's approach to the question of executive privilege, because he knew that Mr. Mitchell had very strong views on that.
And did the meeting end on that note?
Yes, sir.